You might have noticed that language models are acting quite a bit smarter now, including responses that look like expert reasoning. Maybe you wondered, how do they do that? Here's an example. Over the holidays, I was visiting family in Southern California when suddenly I heard a delightful little bird, one that's similar but different from where I live, and it sounds like this. That's from a short recording I took through an open window. Afterwards, I sent a message to GPT-5.2 asking, what might be the bird that we hear singing but don't see in the attached recording taken in December in Thousand Oaks, California? And here's the reply. I can't see the bird, but the sound pattern in your recording is actually pretty diagnostic. And for December in Thousand Oaks, there's a strong front runner, most likely white-crowned sparrow. It then gave the reasons for its answer. And that's ultimately the subject of this video. Let's look at what a language model is actually doing when it writes something like this. From the audio and its spectrogram, the song shows clear whistled notes, not buzzy or raspy, repeated short phrases, notes concentrated roughly in the 3 to 6 kilohertz range, a simple, structured pattern rather than a long improvisation. That's classic white-crowned sparrow song structure, often described as pure whistles followed by a brief trill. In Southern California, they're abundant winter residents and are famously heard more often than seen, especially in shrubs and hedges. I'd say that sounds very plausible. And as we saw, the answer was defended by relevant supporting evidence. If we think about the classic description of how an LLM works, in simplistic terms, predicting the next token, I think it's fair to say that several things about this particular answer seem to go beyond just that. And there's more. It also writes, white-crowned sparrows migrate south for winter, are very common in Ventura County from fall through early spring, and frequently sing even outside peak breeding season, especially on mild days. So, the model put together additional supporting evidence that wasn't explicitly stated in my question. It correctly accounted for the fact that Thousand Oaks, California is located within Ventura County, and that December is wintertime, and that white-crowned sparrows migrate, and that this is exactly when they're quite likely to be found in that part of the world. Well, that's very good. So the model considered the song structure and the location and the time of year and even the fact that the bird itself was not visible in the video, which maps to its learned knowledge, sings from cover, often unseen. In short, GPT-5.2 is doing something here that looks a lot like expert reasoning. So that's our question. How does a language model do that exactly? And for that, I'll skip the technical details about how the model probably processed my QuickTime movie and converted it into a wave-like representation for analysis. Instead, I'll focus on the reasoning process itself, which used that waveform as an input, and I'll focus there because we've come a long way on that. You recall that in the early years, we sometimes saw language models contradict themselves, especially if we asked a question in two different ways, kind of like what lawyers refer to as leading the witness. In fact, sometimes these models even contradicted themselves a bit in the same reply. But this response we saw just now was very coherent, very consistent, and well supported with evidence. And we can attribute this improvement in performance primarily to 5 key developments. First, natural language inference, or NLI for short, which was introduced by this paper, which established a large-scale data set that could be used to test whether a model was able to correctly identify logical relationships between sentences, and to recognize whether statements fit together or clash. That data set became the benchmark for NLI. And that was a great start. But this paper showed us that some of the early successes in NLI didn't actually reflect a true understanding of those logical relationships. Often, models were simply picking up on surface patterns that happened to produce the right answer. In short, even with NLI, we still had work to do to get to where we are today. Next came an interesting and useful finding. It turns out that when models are asked to describe their reasoning process, they're less likely to contradict themselves. In particular, this paper demonstrated that when models generate and compare multiple lines of reasoning, they converge on more stable, more accurate answers. Parallel to that, there emerged another key enabler, reinforcement learning from human feedback, or RLHF for short. I'm sure you've heard of that. It's a way of training AI where people give feedback on its answers, and over time, the model learns to produce responses that people think of as more helpful or more accurate or more appropriate. And of course, we usually think of this as a way to minimize the chances of an LLM producing offensive or inappropriate content. But it also plays a role here, because during RLHF, outputs that people think of as contradictory or incoherent tend to be penalized. Building on that, this paper introduced something called self-critique and revision loops, where models evaluate their own outputs for consistency and then generate a corrected version. The authors call this critique then revise. Looking back then, we started by getting models to explain their thinking, and then we realized something even more powerful was possible. They could check themselves. So, instead of answering once and moving on, the model effectively double-checks itself by reasoning through the problem from multiple angles. And when those independent checks converge on the same answer, that result is given more weight. So, it's more likely to be the final output. And now finally, we arrive at the multimodal aspect of our case. This paper from DeepMind, and also this one from Meta, both describe ways to combine and align information across multiple modalities, as our model did, when information from an audio spectrogram was combined with other information to arrive at an overall most likely bird species. So, this means that, technically, our model was not trying to decide, is this a white-crowned sparrow? Nor was it comparing against some gold standard database of bird calls, looking for the closest match. If it did that, the result would be a score. But then it wouldn't be able to explain as well why it proposed its answer. Instead, it was asking something more like, which hypothesis allows me to generate the most internally consistent explanation given all the available evidence? So, the difference between those early language models and the capabilities we see today is a combined result of innovations like natural language inference, plus reasoning out loud, plus RLHF plus critique then revise. Enhanced, in our case, with methods that allow all this to happen across multiple modalities, including audio. And as you might guess, this recipe we've described isn't just applicable to bird calls. The same pipeline can be used to select the most plausible medical diagnosis, for example, or for root cause analysis within systems or a host of other problem types. And that's why this is so powerful and why it's useful to understand conceptually how this actually works. So now, to close things out, let's invite back our subject matter expert on birdsong for his closing remarks. Meanwhile, thanks for watching and see you next time.